This particular subject on the Bible study about what about sacred names is sort of lingering around the edges of the church at almost all times, and it has over the years, because people use various, you know, the names are real important to them. And so, first of all, you say, well, why is this even an issue? So let's take a look. There's in Acts 4:12 is really a foundational verse. In Acts 4:12, nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. So there's this focus that there has to be a name if salvation is involved. And so this is really, and some people use this to base their ideology on. Well, let's take a look. What is this is a basic question. From this issue, they say, well, then there can only be one way to write or to speak the sacred name of God or Jesus Christ, and that they develop that ideology from that. Well, what is a name? What's in a name? It's an identification or a description. And along with that, and you might say an identification would be that you might recognize Goliath of Gath. Well, you got a pretty good idea. There's this giant that David fought. If I say Peter the Great, you might think of a Russian czar. If I say Richard the Lionhearted, and of course, most of us have seen or heard the story of Robin Hood and Richard the Lionhearted, the King of England, perhaps Ivan the Terrible. And nowadays, we use a first name and a last name, and sometimes a middle name. If you're a kid, you know you're in trouble if you hear your middle name coming out in the whole sequence of things. So, now my grandfather did not have a middle name. He was a Norwegian, and Norwegians were named after their father. So. His wife was Martha Lars' daughter. Martha Lars' daughter was the daughter of Lars Amdahl. So Lars had a daughter, Lars' daughter. And when Thorvald came to the United States, he said, well, everybody has a last name, and you can't just be your father's and then add the word son onto it. So it was a little awkward, and he said, well, his father was John, but there's too many Johnsons. He wasn't going to just be not related to any of them. So he took the name of his, where he came from in that little area in Norway. So that's how he was named Thorvald Vatland or Watland. And so, but no middle name, because that was an American custom. And his son, named then James Watland, to anglicize it, but again, no middle name. It wasn't until the next generation comes about where we started pulling in middle names. So they're a descriptive name for a family, a descriptive name perhaps like of a farm or an origin. Lars Amdahl, he didn't, his last name, he was from the Amdahl farm, or that heritage in Norway. And so when you hear the name, whether it's Lars' son or Lars' daughter, you're coming in the father's name, is the way historically it's been throughout cultures, and many cultures, not all cultures, but many around the world. So this coming in the father's name has significance. It's an identifier as to who we are. It also has a conveyance of authority or responsibility. So if you have the name of someone you introduce, you say, well, I'm here on behalf of so-and-so. Well, you're bringing the responsibility or the authority of the person whom you've named, whether it's you're an ambassador representing another country or another national leader. You have this with the name. Now, we've heard of people who are name droppers, right? You drop a name because that's going to give you some of their authority or responsibility that comes through. So the name is historically quite important. Now, if we look in the Bible, we have a number of name changes. We'll recall that Abram's name was changed to Abraham to reflect his covenant with God. He is called Abraham because he became the father of many nations. So this new name would describe him better in the Hebrew language. Jacob's name, originally Jacob meant supplanter. It was changed later to Israel, which was prevailer with God. So it described him more completely. But you'll notice those names were changed within their native language. So let's take a look now in John 5:43. And in John 5:43, what is Jesus Christ saying? In John 5:43, I've come in my Father's name, and you do not receive me. If another comes in his own name, him you will receive. So Jesus Christ was reporting, you know, who he's conveying that sense of responsibility, the sense of authority that he brought when he's explaining his value to the people that he's speaking to, coming in God's name, in his Father's name. Now, if we take a look also then in John 10:25, we're in the book of John, we have Jesus saying this statement. Jesus answered them, I told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. So it was his life that was a witness to the Father. So he was doing them on authority or under the responsibility, Jesus Christ was, of his Father. So you say, well, who is this? Who are we talking about? And this is where the names issue comes in. And there's a lot of, and really what we're speaking about, are four letters, YHWH. In Greek, it's called the tetragrammaton, meaning four letters together, the YHWH, commonly spoken of as Yahweh, Jehovah, but there's no way to pronounce it because there are no vowels here and historically that the vowels were imputed or implied because they were told, don't pronounce the vowels because that would be not worshiping God properly because we couldn't possibly say God's name right. So therefore, they were told, the Hebrews were told, don't pronounce the name for a long time, and the actual pronunciation was lost. Now, and that happened in the time, I believe, of Jeremiah, so and prior. So, but the Father's name is pretty important. The Son came in the Father's name. We just read that with regard to Jesus Christ. We also made earlier reference to Abraham and the children of Abraham, of Jacob to Israel and the children of Israel. Unless you bear the name of your heavenly Father, you're not his son or his heir. So the inheritance was critical as to, well, who are you inheriting what from? Well, in the Old Testament, there are quite a few different names for God. If we look in Exodus 6:3, what does God say to Moses? I appear to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob as God Almighty, but by my name, Lord, I was not known to them. The Lord is actually, when we see it in our English Bible, is actually YHWH. So prior to that time, Moses knew the YHWH, but Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob did not. So they were known to God as God Almighty or Elohim. So this brings up an interesting question then. Should we be required to use YHWH when addressing God or speaking his name in public and so forth? And this is where the whole part of the issue of sacred names come out. If that were so, then required for salvation, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob aren't going to be in the kingdom of God. Let's take a look here in Exodus 3:15. In Exodus 3:15, God said to Moses, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent you to me. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial to all generations." Well, this, the word that we just that we read in Exodus 3:15 is the word Elohim, whereas the word Lord is the word YHWH. So God is referring to himself by both names in Exodus 3:15. And yet some who follow the sacred names theology, they insist that we only use the second name and not the first name. So you have this dichotomy there for that belief system. Now, but that's not only names. There are other names in the Old Testament for God. If we take a look in the books of Ezra and the book of Daniel, they don't refer at all to YHWH. They refer to God using Aramaic names, Elah, Eloah, Elah. They don't use the names Elohim or YHWH. So, which is interesting, in fact, the that God can be referred to in the Old Testament by numerous different actual names, not just titles. Now, we take a look, the Bible was written in different languages. The Old Testament was written in Hebrew, except for parts of what we just mentioned were in Aramaic. That was mentioned in Ezra and such. So for the most part, Old Testament was written in Hebrew, and the New Testament was written in Greek. And I put down the possible exception of Matthew and Hebrews because it appears that they were written in Aramaic, but then translated by Luke into Greek for the general audience. So that, but we don't have any original. If they were written in Aramaic, we don't have the original. We do have lots of copies of the Greek that was done at that time. And of course, part of it, that what we know about it is when the writer, and Mark in particular, and I don't have this verse here, I probably have it in my notes, is when Christ, Jesus, was hanging on the stake of crucifixion. And his last words were, interestingly enough, in Aramaic. And it was, even though Mark was written in Greek, it was saying, here's his words, and then they isolated them out as if they were quotes and saying, in Aramaic, and then the words say, and translated, and this is the translation of what it means. So it's interesting then that if there was, in other words, it was, into God I transmit my spirit. The reflection or the, this was an opportunity if Jesus Christ were going to establish for sure of using a special name, then he would have done so. Okay. But it was used in both Greek and Aramaic and preserved for us in Greek. In this Mark example, another Mark example in Mark 9, verse 38, one of the disciples answered Christ. Now John answered him saying, "Teacher, we saw someone who does not follow us, who's casting out demons in your name." He's talking to Jesus Christ. "And we forbade him because he doesn't follow us." In other words, he's not one of our group. And he's out there using your name, Jesus, to cast out demons. Well, what did Christ say? Saying, well, he didn't use the wrong name. He's toast. No, he didn't say that. We just keep reading in Mark 9, verse 39. But Jesus says, "Do not forbid him, for no one who works a miracle in my name can soon afterwards speak evil of me." Going on to verse 40. "For he who is not against us is on our side. For whoever gives you a cup of water to drink in my name, because you belong to Christ, assuredly I say to you, he will by no means lose his reward." So Christ isn't condemning them for casting out demons in his name. He said, it's okay. Just You know, don't get all uptight about this. Just relax. It's going to be okay because they're not against us. Okay. Now, perhaps the most dramatic demonstration about whether it's required to use a sacred name for God in only one, and you got to know how to pronounce it in only one language or one ancient way and so forth, is in Acts 2 and verses 1 through 4. Now, this is the striking beginning of the New Testament church and about the day of Pentecost. So in Acts 2, verses 1 through 4, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as if a rushing of a mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. So we have the incoming of the Holy Spirit upon the disciples who were becoming apostles. And we continue on in verse 3, Acts 2, verse 3. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as if fire, and one sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Or you could say one definition of tongues would be language. They spoke in different languages. So now these new apostles were speaking in a language that they would understand. Now, why would they do this? Because there were people from all over the world, and as we looked at earlier, why were they there? Well, the Jews called it the Feast of Weeks and several other terms, and so they were gathered. Now, this particular picture that I'm going to show here is a picture of the steps upon which this, according to, and my brother and his wife were there, and the Jewish guide said, this is where the church started, on these steps, which is where the Holy Spirit was distributed, where the apostles had spoke the various languages. So I thought it would include this. He pulled it out of an Israeli magazine to be able to demonstrate. They called it the Foreigner's Gate. This particular gate or entrance toward the temple was where the people from all over the world would come. This particular entrance, where all of these people from all of these different languages would be. Well, if you've been to an international concourse at an airport, you will hear lots of different languages all in one place. So I can only imagine what a kind of a zoo it was at that day. And if we go on in Acts 2, starting in verse 5, and there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when this sound occurred, the sound of the wind coming in, the multitude came together and were confused, because everyone heard them speak in his own language. Then they were all amazed and marveled, saying to one another, look, are not all these who speak Galileans? And how is it that we hear each in our own language in which we were born? They didn't say, oh, wow, we're hearing everything, but they're using Hebrew for certain names. We didn't hear that. There was no description of that or insistent. Well, we've got to follow this Jewish custom, meaning the local custom there. And if we read on in verse 9, talks about the people from around the world, the Parthians, the Medes, Elamites, those dwelling in Mesopotamia, which is modern-day Iraq, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, meaning up in the modern-day Turkey, Phrygia and Pamphylia, also in modern-day Turkey, Egypt and parts of Libya adjoining Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them speaking in our own tongues the wonderful works of God. How could they understand if it were in some other language that they would be compelled to use? Well, the answer is that the name of God was spoken in many languages. We have this evidence right before us, right here. But that's not the only piece of evidence we have. We have other New Testament evidence. The Apostle Paul translated YHWH into the Greek word theos. The words that he used for creator, also in the New Testament, logos is a Greek word meaning the word. Kyrios is translated as Lord. Christos is translated as Christ or the Anointed One. Yesuus is translated as Jesus. So you have these Hebrew words translated into Greek and then into English. And there is no evidence that says that these words have to be in a sacred name format. Nowhere in the New Testament do the Hebrew words for God appear. That alone should be a shocking thing for people if you're looking at evidence. But wait, there's more. In John 17, in verse 11, we have more New Testament evidence. John 17, verse 11, "Now I am no longer in the world," but this is what Christ, Jesus is saying, "but these are in the world, and I come to you, Holy Father, keeping through your name those who you have given me, that they may be one as we are." Now, if Jesus Christ were to say, we have to use a sacred name, this would be a great place to do it. In other words, but we don't hear that here. We don't see that here. He referred to him by his description as Holy Father and saying, keep through your name. So the Father's name is God, if we're speaking English. It's Theos, if we're speaking Greek. Now, of course, the New Testament was written in Greek, and so they translate Theos to the word God. Jesus called himself the Son of Theos, or the Son of God, numerous times. It's not just an individual occurrence. We can also look at further evidence in the New Testament. So before we accept the theories of some that it's wrong to use anything but the Hebrew YHWH, or that salvation is only possible through the use of one name, we need to recognize the overwhelming evidence to the contrary in the New Testament. In 1 Corinthians 11:1, I'm going to quote from the Common English Bible. What does Paul write to the church in Corinth? "Follow my example, just like I follow Christ's." And what did Paul, and what did Christ do? He did not conform to the idea of a sacred name. He used multiple names for God the Father and himself. And Paul says, follow Christ, follow me as I follow Christ's example. And what did Paul do? He was also using the Greek terminology. So we should be aware that the evidence here in the New Testament is overwhelming, that neither Jesus Christ nor Paul ordered or compelled the use of a sacred name. Now, is it a sin to use any of those names? I don't find anything in the Bible that's a sin to use a variety of names. The problem becomes, and that is in Proverbs 6, 16 through 19. What does God hate? The seven things God hates. In Proverbs 6, 19, he lists, and it's in an increasing order of the seven things that God hates. And we get to the seventh thing. He hates sowing discord among the brethren. And that's what we have to be careful for, is departing from the scripture for people who have the idea that, and then they want to make an issue about it and compel everybody else to, when neither Jesus nor Paul or other writers in the New Testament. So that's the evidence that I wanted to present today to answer the question, is a Christian required to use a particular sacred name? And our strongest evidence is the day of Pentecost, standing on those steps, the foreigners at the foreigner's gate, when all of the people gathering for the Feast of Pentecost all heard the words of God spoken through the apostles, all in their own language. So what about sacred names? It's just something that you should be aware of, build up our biblical knowledge of, and recognize to use a particular name, if it's in the Bible, is not a sin, but to be careful about trying to compel others to do so or causing division.